Happy Hanukkah. I just wanted to take a second and recognize two special people. I'm working on a new book, and two of the lovely artists are here. And Mort and Jenny Linder, will you please stand up? And Jenny made this beautiful cape that I'm going to show you.
So, Ari, first of all, I want to thank you for the work you do and the way you are acknowledging older women, their beauty, their dignity, their creativity. It's just so important and so refreshing. So thank you very, very much. So you credit your grandmothers with getting you started on this road. Would you elaborate a little bit and tell us about their influence in your life?
I grew up in San Diego, and both my grandmothers had a huge impact on me. My father's mother, and my dad's in the front row, Helen, was always beautifully dressed, very intelligent, never left the house without her red lipstick and her hair done, and always promoted education like a good Jewish grandmother. And my other grandmother, Bluma, was really my best friend and the one that I spent most time with. I spent more time with her than anyone my own age. And she had gone to Columbia University. She was a librarian. And really encouraged me at a young age to feel okay with expressing my creativity, dressing up, looking through her closet, not being afraid to put on a sparkly necklace or my grandfather's, you know, Stetson hat, or, you know, just to play and have fun. And I don't think I ever lost that. And she really made me think of aging as a very positive thing. And I know everyone has a grandmother, and people always ask, why did I do this? And I can't explain it other than I've always had this really deep connection to older people. I wanted to be an entertainment director for a nursing home when I was younger. That was my dream.
You got another career.
And in a way, you know, I'm able now to work with all these incredible older people, men and women. And, you know, she introduced me to old film, she's the first person who encouraged me to start collaging, and I made my first book of drawings of older women all dressed up when I was like 7 years old. So this is just an extension of something I've done my whole life. I think they taught me how to treat people well, and I mean, yeah, it's hard to explain. They were everything to me.
So, Deborah, we loved seeing you in the movie. I love looking at what you're wearing, and we're going to get into that. But first of all, I want to hear how you and Ari met.
Oh, it's my favorite part of the story. Ari was managing the bookstore at the New Museum in New York, and I walked in with my very good friend who's in the audience, Susan Wick. She was visiting New York. It was a rainy day. We left our umbrellas and coats at the coat check, and before I knew it, this young man runs up to me and says, I take pictures of women over 60. Can I take your picture? And I blurted out, how do you know I'm over 60?
How old were you at the time?
62.
She had pink hair.
Yeah, I had pink hair, as you saw in the film. And then he realizes he forgot his camera home, so he borrowed somebody's iPhone and took a few shots, and I whipped out my business card and I said, come on over, I'll dress up, I'll undress, and I'll even make you a vegetarian lunch. 5 days passed, I didn't hear from him, so I called him and he came over. So we spent the entire day photographing everything in my house and me cooking and dressing and the art on the walls and whatever, and we were friends after that. And then 2 weeks later, he met Lina, the director of the film, and they decided to collaborate, and she came over, and she was then doing video segments of some of us. And so she's from Lithuania, I'm half Lithuanian, and I said, okay, Lina, I'm gonna adopt you. I had already adopted Ari. And so she became a good buddy, and then after doing a series of videos, the two of them, they decided, okay, I think we've got a film, because there was just so much interest in the videos. The film came about. So the two of them were great collaborators.
So let's get into some of what you're wearing, starting with, and if you can't see it too well, I hope you'll be in the atrium afterwards so people can get an up-close look. Tell me about the necklace.
Well, I was just gifted the necklace on Sunday. I have two friends who have a very interesting business. It's called Project Just, and they're interested in the transparency in the whole fashion industry. And one lives in Dubai, and one lives in New York, and I had brunch with them. And the one from Dubai is really from Saudi, and her aunt is now working in Saudi with Syrian refugees, and they made the necklace, and she gifted me. And it's all wrapped threads, and it's absolutely beautiful. And there's a little piece of embroidery on the bottom, and this is work of the Saudi ladies, and she's also working with the Saudi ladies doing embroidered clothing and getting back to the true essence of clothing as we knew it before the whole industry has gotten so polluting.
And I saw in the movie that sometimes you use toilet paper rolls to make bracelets. Is that what this is?
Yeah.
Oh, I can't wait till you can see it up close. It has the most intricate fabric, several different fabrics and leather, and it's just, who would think?
It's just all recycled materials. We all have toilet paper rolls. And, you know, postcards, brochures, catalogs that come in the mail, the images are too beautiful to throw away, so I save them all. And then I just do collage on the cardboard with other fabrics and mesh produce bags. My friends in the audience are all textile people, and so a lot of the stuff comes from them. They send me fabric scraps, and in fact, I'm doing a workshop on Monday out in Berkeley at my friend Ellen Hopley's studio. So oftentimes when we do these films, I do related workshops.
Now, I know that you have a degree in textiles from UC Berkeley, so you have spent time on the West Coast, but this film, as I said earlier, is really New York-centric. And I think you make a comment in the beginning of the film that women get to strut their stuff on the streets of New York because they walk all the time, which we do in San Francisco, certainly more than LA. But talk about New York and the role of New York in this film. And you too, Deborah, having been on the West Coast and in New York. So Ari, start, because you came from Southern California to New York.
Well, my grandmother told me when I was really young that if I wanted to be creative, I should move to New York. And I think she always missed her time in New York because she grew up in Sioux City, Iowa, and then went to grad school at Columbia and then made her way to Los Angeles where her mother and the rest of her family moved. And so as a really young boy, I just envisioned going there and sort of reliving those days that she used to speak about. And when she passed away is when I decided, okay, now it's the time to move to New York City. And I think now, reflecting back, I started this project in 2008 as a blog where I was just photographing all these women on the streets of New York that I started to meet, and then it turned into a book and in the film and now a new book. And I think I was sort of searching for my grandmother again and finding little bits of her in each one of these women. Lina's wanted to make New York a very strong character in the film, and these women are very New York, but you know, people say, oh, I can never dress like this in other cities, but that's so not true. I mean, I travel everywhere for my work, and look at Virginia's beautiful work, and so many people in the audience, and it's just about doing what makes you feel good. I just moved to Los Angeles, but I loved my time in New York, and I don't think that this would have happened without being there. There's just so much life and color and everything on the streets.
Let's not forget Paris, because a nod to my friend Pascal. I mean, what about you, Deborah? What about your perception of East Coast, West Coast fashion? Tell the truth.
Well, I'm a native New Yorker, and I don't know if it's geography. I mean, I have to blame everything that I do on my mother and my grandmother. And because they were the greatest supporter, at age 3, I was always allowed to dress any way I wanted, and everything was a hat from a paper bag to a lampshade, and it was encouraged. And of course, when I came to UC Berkeley, that changed my life, as all my friends. friends out there will attest to. We had a professor, Ed Rossback, maybe some of you know him, but East Coast College was completely different than UC Berkeley. East Coast College was very, we're going to chew you up and spit you out and destroy you and see if we can't break you. Came to Berkeley, and everything was positive criticism. And it was like life-changing. And, you know, 1967, 69. And my photographer, Dimitri, who photographed my master's dissertation, is here in the audience, and I haven't seen him in over 30 years. So he's the first photographer I worked with, and Ari's the current one. And they're both
I'm out now. She has so many people wanting to take her picture.
So what's so interesting to me, and the work you do is such an antidote to these 12 and 13-year-old prepubescent girls that rule the runways. But the fashion designers are all older people. I mean, the revered ones. If you talk about Giorgio Armani, if you talk about Ralph Lauren, if you talk about, Donna Karen and Vogue, Anna Wintour. So what happened? Talk a little bit about how models got younger and younger and thinner and thinner, and how did things get so out of whack?
Well, I mean, the whole focus of this project is really about lifestyle and vitality and really sort of thinking the way we view aging and the picture of aging. And so I was initially drawn by all these women's incredible style, but I don't really think too much about the fashion industry itself. But what's interesting is since I started the project, there have been a lot of changes happening in ad campaigns and lifestyle and fashion media. As you see in the film, I was approached by Lon Vaughn to cast a campaign with two of the women from Advanced Style. Deborah did a Kmart. She's been, you know, modeling for a few years now. All these, and if you, so there's been a big change in that, and it's sort of created this movement where now you're seeing older models on the runway and ad campaigns, and I think people are waking up to the fact that this is not only an important demographic, but, you know, they have the more economic means to be buying the things that are being sold by designers. But there's just this culture of fear of around aging, and that's anywhere from the fashion industry to, the New York Times. I mean, there's so much ageism. And, you know, I think at this point, people are starting to look at old as being cool. I don't know how long that will last within the fashion industry, because the fashion industry is very fickle and it's always about what's new and the next thing. But to me, that's not what's important. What's important is to see these images, and hopefully they will, well, they have. I mean, I get emails from young girls from 12 to, you know, women in their 30s who say now they can no longer, they can't wait to grow older because of these women, and they're, you know, lessening their fears when they see that first wrinkle or the gray hair. They're dyeing their hair gray. They can't wait to have as much freedom as the women. So I think there's a lot of changes being made.
And you have Diane Keaton, and you have Charlotte Rampling, and you have Helen Mirren, and we have some really pretty great examples now of women growing old beautifully and unapologetically, and I just love it. You say something in the film, Deborah, and I think it's expressed throughout the film, about there is really a freedom that comes, I find in my own life, a freedom that comes with age, and part of it's, I don't have to do that anymore, or I don't have to pretend that anymore, or particularly for women, I don't have to do that for him anymore. So tell us about that in your own, yeah, right. Tell us about that in your own life.
Well, I think there is a greater freedom, and I first felt it at 50, like I didn't have to answer to anyone. And at that time, I wasn't married, I wasn't with a partner, so I didn't have a male person I had to, bow down to, although I don't think I ever did. But I think just with maturity and being in the world, and, you know, you're not necessarily building a career, you're not raising children, and so there is greater freedom. And I feel that in the aging process, one of the most important things to address is your health. And I think whether you eat well, exercise, but creativity is also very important.
I think that was an amen.
Okay. And as Ari and I were discussing before, we were talking about staying curious and discovering new things. And one of the ladies in the fashion show said, I've never done this before. I said, that's all the more reason you're doing it now.
Our fashion show tonight.
Yeah, so in the green room, she mentioned that. So the whole idea of having new experiences, maintaining friendships. I mentor a lot of young students, and we throw parties all the time, as my partner Stan and I. So we invite young people and older people because we're learning from each other. And as Ari said, he gets emails from young people, and so do I all the time, that they're at 25, they're fearing aging. And the mere fact that they appreciate us and we can all be in the same room and share, it's really gratifying.
I'd love to hear about that, Ari. Tell me about some of the mail you get and interactions you have with young people.
Well, I said it in the film, and now the film is online as well, and so people will stop me in the streets and sort of recognize me and say how these women have affected their views on aging. And that's the most amazing part of starting this, because I really just started out of the love of my grandmother. I'd never taken a photograph before. I just hit the streets and started to do this as a way for me to connect to older people. And then I realized that they had the power, these men and women, to change our perceptions of aging. But so many different stories. A woman emailed me a few years ago saying, one of the women in the project is now 103, and she does Pilates every week, twice a week. And she's now been featured in like Pilates magazines and Dr. Oz. And so this woman, on her 50th birthday, by the time she hit 50, she lost 50 pounds because she was inspired by Ruth. And so, I mean, the power of the internet and the power of, you know, just putting something positive online, because there's so much negativity. And so it happens every day, and it's mm-hmm. just really wonderful that I can just sit on my computer in my at my little desk and post a picture and see how it affects people.
I just want to say one thing about Ari. As you've seen in the movie, he's so non-threatening when he comes up to people, and he's, yeah, right.
Well, it depends on who you ask.
Right.
So subtle.
Yeah, and he's not judgmental, and he really, you know, his grandmother taught him well. He really does embrace us, and you can feel his sincerity, that he's not in this as a career, even though it's turned into that. But at the beginning, it totally came from a non-self-conscious place. And his sincerity and honesty is really, really there.
It also struck me that some of the women in the film are artists, but almost all of you, certainly you, Deborah, use your body as your canvas. I mean, what you do, what you create is your art. And I know I have several friends who are really fabulous fashionistas, and that's a good word. And it never occurred to me before how much of that is art, and that is an expression of an artistic nature. So talk about that a little bit.
Well, I think it's the first act we do in the morning, and I see it as a morning meditation, because it's quiet time to really check in, who am I today for myself, capital S, and how I want to feel for the day, depending on my activity, the weather, my mood, and then how I want to present myself to the world. So I don't see it as narcissistic. For me, it really is a meditation, and it is an act of creativity. And as I say in the film, it's my ABCs, assembling, building, and constructing on this body, which is my armature. And again, I think I've been doing it since I'm 3 years old. And everybody can do it, and you can do it in your own capacity. I mean, it's not brain surgery. So if you dress up and you think you're over the top, and you look in the mirror, and suddenly you feel like you look like a clown, then you take the nose off. And then you pull back the next day. And so it's an experimentation, and it's all play.
And sometimes you want to look like a clown. But that's what I look for, is people who really embrace that art of dressing, and it's not one particular style. And a lot of the people that I interview and speak to about style and lifestyle talk about how it's, you know, this has been a love of theirs since they were little, and that act of playing and continuing to play throughout your lives. And at some point, and this was part of Lena's wanting to film the women that I was photographing, is thinking about why do people, certain people stop at a certain point. Maybe it's for a career, maybe it's to find a partner, whatever, you know, judgments are happening from society, and the ones that continue to play and dress up, and then some people rediscover it as they get older and become even more flamboyant. And today, I don't usually talk about this, but I had a little bit of a cold, and I put this jacket on, and I felt so much better. And I think there really is, you know, that power of style. It changes your mood. When you look in the mirror, and you know you're doing it for yourself. You're not doing it for other people.
Deborah, you said in the film when you were talking about finding your partner and your relationship with him, that there was a point at which you thought you scared him off because you were too over the top. I want to explore that a little bit.
Well, as he said, he thought I looked like a clown.
Right.
And
dialed it back.
Yeah.
So how did that feel?
On the first meeting, that's what happened, and then we didn't see each other for 5 years, and then we accidentally re-met at an event. And so, as I said, I did dial it back, and I really looked in the mirror, and I tried to see what a normal person would see. And, you know, I remember exactly what I wore on that first date, you know, a very simple green cotton summer dress, no jewelry, little makeup. I mean, I felt underdressed, but I said, all right, this is an experiment, let me see. And we went out, and then the other thing, which I think is funny, is afterwards we went out for a beer, and I don't really drink beer, and I'm not really a drinker, and I ordered hot water and lemon. And I did that on the second date, and I said, you know what, he thinks I'm weird enough, I think I better order a glass of wine. So at least he can relate to me as a normal 62-year-old woman at the time.
To what extent do you think, by and large, women do dress for men?
I have to interrupt because
heterosexual women.
I have to interrupt because her partner Stan likes to dress up just as much or more as her. They thrift store shop together. He loves the way she looks, and so that was sort of in your own head at that point.
Well, I mean, we were both different people 9, 10 years ago, or it was 15 years ago when we first met. So, yeah, I mean, we're really both on the same page in many, many things, and thrifting is certainly one of those things, because it's our ritual, you know. When we go for a destination, it's towards a thrift shop. So.
I think there is a culture of, and I'm obviously speaking for women, but in general, of people dressing up, like I said, to attract and for their partners. But it seems like a lot of the women that I photograph really are dressing for themselves more than anyone else. Mm-hmm. And I think that is, you know, a lot of times people will ask me, what's the difference between the way younger people dress and the way that the women and men that you photograph dress? And I think it's that whole point of not being self-conscious and really doing something that makes you happy, and you can let go of that fear of being yourself. And I've had that. I'm 34, and I've even, you know, gone through those cycles of when I was younger, I, you know, wore anything out of anyone in my family's closets. And then, you know, you start thinking about, oh, I have to meet someone, and I have to dial this down. And then eventually, you just get sick of all that, and you want to be yourself. Yeah.
Tell us about Iris Apfel, who's in your film, and who has become, who became such a phenomenon. I mean, just because of her personality, or what happened there? What was it that created the phenomenon of Iris Apfel?
Well, I knew about Iris before I came to New York, because as a lot of you might have seen her film, she had a huge show at the Met of all of her clothing that she had collected, because she had a business called Old World Weavers, which they made fabrics and...
they're also in the interior design
yeah,
business,
and so they got into fabrics. like it was 18th, 19th century renditions of things, and she did the interior design and the drapery for like the White House through seven presidents and worked with many fashion designers. So the reason why she was so well known in New York is she was working with all these really high profile people, and she sold her business to Stark. And I mean, she had a huge business in interior design, and so people were sort of recognizing her for the way she dressed, and then she had this Met show. And I think that she's just gotten bigger and bigger. And even when I walk down the streets and someone might know me, they bring up Iris, because she's in her 90s. She's still so vital, traveling the world, doing her thing. And obviously she has an incredible collection, and she has a sense of humor about the way she dresses. And it's that element of play like that I see in so many other people. And I think that she doesn't take herself too seriously. And I think it sort of gives people, you can see people who are dressed straight out of a store on Madison Avenue or here at Neiman Marcus, and you know, in a way that's unattainable. But you can put on, you know, an armload of full of bracelets or a great necklace or a great hat. And I think that her style, in a way, shows people that you can still have fun, and people can relate to her in a way, because they can relate to that sort of process. Yeah. Of accessorizing and building and the joy of dressing.
And very eclectic, you know, so that you're not just reading labels when she steps into a room, but it's a real piece of sculpture.
And also, and I think this is part of what you do, there's the hunt to find that piece, and it might be in a thrift shop, and it might be at a flea market. Well, here we are in an age where our own De Young Museum has done a number of Gautier and shows, designer fashion shows, and certainly they've been in New York, so this doesn't seem like there's any slowing down in the public regard for fashion as art. It just seems to be a steamroller. Mm-hmm. So, we're going to turn to the audience and take some questions or comments, and we want to see what you look like. But before we do, and before the lights come up, Ari and Deborah, anything else you want to add about this experience, the film, the blog, how your life has grown and flourished under this?
Deborah's changed my life.
Ari's changed my life. Well, we have traveled a lot together, and we just have a grand time. And we've become really good friends, and with Lina also, and it has changed my life. I'm doing more teaching again, more traveling, and it's simpler and better than ever. So it is better with age, as long as we stay healthy and happy.
Ari?
Well, the project has definitely not only changed my perceptions of aging, although that was positive to begin with, but just show me the possibilities, you know, and how you can, if you have that mindset, that optimism, there's no limit to what you can do, and you can do new things, and you can start drawing, you can start painting. My dad just retired, and he started two radio shows. If you guys love smooth jazz, check out Smooth Jazz Live on Facebook. And, you know, so many of these women are now rediscovering things in themselves, that they have more time to develop. And Deborah, in particular, was the first person I met who, like she said, invited me into her home and really extended this project that I was doing in New York on the streets to really talking about the way you can live a really creative and vital life. And since then, we've traveled to so many different things, including, like, we were at a conference in the Midwest about aging and disability, and it was run by this great organization that worked with social workers to find, you know, community centers that were really helping people in rural communities, which was so different than obviously our experience, but they invited us to have a new perspective on aging, and it was so interesting because in a way we thought, how can they relate to us? But all the social workers came up to us and said, well, all these people who live in these rural communities, well, they weave, they do, you know, they're all sort of crafty people. And so they thought about new ideas. We did a workshop where we had a roundtable discussion, and now it's all about creating community. We talk about creativity and community and connecting. And so now, you know, some of them might not have a museum to go to, but they have the gas station, and that's where they have a bench. And so now they're gonna start projects where everyone meets at the bench at the gas station, and they have a weaving circle. And so it's been an incredible gift, and for my grandmother to be able to do this and travel and hear stories and wisdom from all these wonderful people.
Wonderful. Well, let's bring the lights up, and we have microphones on either side. And if you want to ask a question or make a comment, just stick up your hand, and there's one right in the front row.
Question for Deborah. Can you hear me?
Yes.
What is at the top of your wish list right now? What are you coveting?
Thank you.
Nothing. Oh, my God. To lighten my load and get rid of stuff. But mostly furniture, not clothing, because clothing you can always shove a little more in the closet. Yes. Yeah.
To your left.
Go ahead.
Hi, I'm dying to know your lip color brand so I can buy it tomorrow.
A friend turned me on to it. It's matte. It's a matte, but it's called Jeffrey. Somebody help me. Oh, wait, I have it in my purse.
Oh, I love the purse.
Oh, a friend, Ari named me. My title is Gifted and Thrifted, because I only shop in thrift shops, and almost once a month I get a box of goods from friends from all over the country and the world. My pants are from a friend from Australia. Somebody in a class gave me this.
It's
the feathers a friend gave me that are on many hats. A friend from Berkeley's mother passed away at 100, and she sent me 3 cartons of hats that I reinvented. Let me look for the lipstick.
Ari, you answer the next question while I've got the lipstick.
Question over here.
This is for Ari. So I guess you've moved to L.A. How will that affect your ability and access to people since the streets of New York are so vibrant? And second, what is it like to be in youth culture with what you're promoting?
Well, living in Los Angeles doesn't really affect my work because I travel for work. So I've been photographing a lot of women. I have a book coming out in May, and so a lot of the women are from Los Angeles, and I've had to meet them through social media now. I'm going to Brazil in a few weeks, and so I'm continuing to travel and photograph people in different places. I guess I didn't really understand the part about youth culture. My friends really love what I'm doing, and they've all become friends with all the women that I photograph, and I think more than anyone who follows what I do, it's a lot of younger people who are really embracing the attitude and the style of these men and women, and wishing that they had as much audacity, boldness, and you know, the actual items of clothing that they have, which takes years of collecting.
Deborah, what's the lipstick?
Sorry?
The lipstick shape.
Oh, Jeffree Star. Jeffree with
Star.
A double E at the end. Jeffree Star. But a lot of the colors are like mauve and flesh, and they're really gorgeous. And I think you can only buy it online. At least that's what I was told.
Okay, on your left here.
Yeah, this question for Ari. I'd like to know if you're going to photograph all the gentlemen. Like the 70.
Well, Mort's in the new book. And the new book has men. And then Lina and I made a video about a men in style. It's on a website called nowness.com. And it's just under advanced style men. And she brought up Gautier. Jean-Paul Gautier just awarded it best styling at a fashion festival. So that was sort of exciting.
Congratulations.
And yes, I am photographing more men now.
And look for the Now Is piece. It is fabulous. Just fabulous.
The what piece? Say that again.
The
video we made. You can just Google
on
Advanced Style Men.
Yeah.
If you want.
Yeah.
Question over here in the center.
Thank you for a great evening. I'm inspired by you and all the other fabulous women that we met tonight. I also want to say that somebody else is fabulous, my mother, who is fabulous because she's probably still the most intelligent, informed person I know, who knows more about politics and economics and the non-creative professions than anybody I know. And I just wanted to add that all of us women over 30 are fabulous, not just because we wear fabulous lipstick, but because there's a lot of very intelligent points of view and, you know, and things to say, and that's, I think, you are a prime example. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. On your front left here.
Ari, here I am.
Hi, Jerry.
Hi. I know you went to a really great West Coast college.
With your son.
Yes, but I don't know what you studied. Can you tell us about that?
Well, I went to University of Washington and studied art history.
Just up there.
Great. Seattle.
In Seattle, yes. Yes, we were.
Question to your right.
Hi. My name's Kat, and I wanted to thank you, Ari, and you, Deborah. It's so amazing because last night, I don't know why I did this, I was doing Pilates, I turned on the television, which I never watch, and I tuned to the Victoria's Secret fashion show. I can hold it. And I, of course, at first was captivated by their great beauty, and there were some amazing costumes where they were wearing wings and all that sort of thing. But then I started crying because their beauty is just so unattainable. And I'm at this stage in my life, I'm 52, I'm a new empty nester, and I'm struggling with feeling sexy. Like, I wanna be a sexy woman, but I don't wanna be garish or gaudy, you know? And then tonight I see you, and you're so inspirational, all of the women in the movie, and it's been such a gift. Thank you for that, and for what you are, and for the vibrancy that you've brought.
Well,
thank you.
Well, one of Sephora's quotes, which I love, and it's not in the film, she said, "Forget tits and ass, wear a hat. You'll get noticed." Yeah. I think it really says it all.
Okay, on your front left here, front left.
Hi, good evening. I wanted to thank you for the wonderful evening of inspiration, because I have a lot of friends of mine that mock me for the way I dress and tell me that I'm too old and I should calm down, and I tell them all to go to hell. But yes, while I say that, it still at times hurts me a lot, because I think that everybody's entitled to wear and be whatever they feel they should be. And none of us should judge anybody. We are all beautiful women and men.
Right.
Thank you. Question in the back.
I saw the movie Iris. Did you have a part in that film?
Well, they filmed part of it at a party that we had that Iris came to. No, we actually started filming it a long time before they started their film. But we sort of didn't put Iris in our film as much because she was starting to make her own film.
And what age is an advanced style?
That changes all the time. Well, it used to be, I think I was so strict and I wanted it to be 65 and older. And Sephora, when I heard about her, was 59. And then so I waited until she got to be like 62 until I photographed her. But now it's not really a specific age. Generally over 60, but obviously it's an attitude more than an age at this point.
Okay, front left here.
Hi, I'm Marisa. So I'm one of the 20-something that emailed you because really got inspired by your movie. I'm from Indonesia originally, so I'm so excited that I can meet you here in San Francisco. And I know that you are now a very successful blogger with a lot of now you have books and everything, but what is your goal in the future? So after, with all of this success, what are you looking forward to? And I also have one more question for Deborah. So a lot of my classmates, they are always complaining, saying, oh my God, I'm already 25, I'm having quarter life crisis, I need to have Botox soon, what should I do? Or even another girl say, I want to die before 50, so I won't look old in my dad. So do you have any word of wisdom to change that perception? Thank you.
My goal is, I don't really think about what my next step is. I like to just do what feels right. And Deborah's really helped me with that because she was a teacher and worked in the flower business, and now she's a healer and teaches workshops. I think my goal is to continue to create a platform for older people that allows for a really optimistic view of aging. And so much of what we see is so negative and concentrates just on the deterioration and what you lose as you age. And so I just want to continue to focus on what you gain as you get older. Deborah, what's your advice for 25-year-olds who want to die before they're 50?
Somehow get a new attitude, an attitude of gratitude. There was an incredible program on BBC the other night narrated by Susan Sarandon, and it was all about the attitude of gratitude. And they had documentation from hospitals all over the world with numbers and statistics and all that proving that gratitude really has a positive effect. I mean, we all knew that, but you know, we need proof, right? We need numbers, statistics, and all that. So I think an attitude of gratitude comes first and foremost at any age. I mean, it's a crazy lunatic planet we're living on now, but we've got to create positive, joyful bubbles around us, and so the energy can go out. That's all we can do. We can't save the planet on a big scale, but we can do it individually. And being kind to the earth and recycle and repurpose, and that's Lynn's gold also. She's totally involved in recycling. So it's those little positive things that we have to do.
And they need to go out and see the world and meet people and, you know, and make some older friends.
Right.
We're going to take two more questions.
Question over here to your right.
Question?
Nowhere on the ticket did it say anything about a movie. And I'm hurt that I didn't see a movie. I think you should have had it on the ticket that there was a movie. And I hope to look forward to seeing it.
We'll tell you how you can see the movie after the program.
One thing that I wanted to ask is, what's your relationship to clothing as art? Now, clothing as art movement was a very exciting movement, and along with the things that you espouse, what's your relationship to it now, or do you think it should be encouraged? Thank you.
I think clothing is art. I don't buy into fashion. I mean, I did my dissertation on what I call before the term wearable art was established. I called it fibrous raiments, and because they were fibrous, and I used the word raiments as kind of an old, obsolete term. And I think anything we put on our body is clothing or wearable, and it can also be art. I mean, I work in a lot of recycled materials when I make art pieces. Back in the 60s, I was working with plastic berry baskets, and I was working with videotape from the television studios when they were still using wide videotape and wire and what have you. So I'm still recycling. But I think if we think of our body as an armature, then we can just build on it and it can be as creative or as minimal as you like. I mean, it's very, very personal, just like any art form.
Last question.
Right here on your left.
Hi, Ari. I'm really inspired by your work. I love going through your blog all the time. And I was just wondering who we should keep an eye out for here in San Francisco.
Front row. look around you in the audience. There's so many beautiful people. that's the thing, is it's really keeping your eyes open. And that's what's been another great thing about this project, is now a lot of my friends will notice older people in the cities that they live in. And they say that this film and book have sort of awakened them to viewing aging differently. And now they're like magnets, and they're drawn to you know, really inspiring people in their lives. So yeah, just keep your eyes open.
So I want to thank Pascal Elser from Pascaline Paris. I want to thank all our wonderful models. I want to thank, of course, Ari and Deborah. And thanks to all of you for being here tonight. Have a wonderful evening.
Thank you very much. And thank you, Barbara, for having us.
Thank you, Barbara.
Ari, you answer the next question while I have
a question
over here.
This is for Ari. So I guess you've moved to LA. How will that affect your ability and access to people, since the streets of New York are so vibrant? And second, what is it like to be in youth culture with what you're promoting?
Well, living in Los Angeles doesn't really affect my work because I travel for work. So I've been photographing a lot of women. I have a book coming out in May, and so a lot of the women are from Los Angeles, and I've had to meet them through social media now. But I'm going to Brazil in a few weeks, and so I'm continuing to travel and photograph people in different places. I guess I didn't really understand the part about youth culture. My friends really love what I'm doing, and they've all become friends with all the women that I photograph. And I think more than anyone who follows what I do, it's a lot of younger people who are really embracing the attitude and the style of these men and women, and wishing that they had as much audacity, boldness, and, you know, the actual items of clothing that they have, which takes years of collecting.
Deborah, what's the lipstick?
Sorry?
The lipstick shape.
Oh, Jeffree Star. Jeffree with a double E at the end. Jeffree Star. But a lot of the colors are like mauve and flesh, and they're really gorgeous. And I think you can only buy it online. At least that's what I was told.
Okay, on your left here.
Yeah, this question is for Ari. I'd like to know if you're going to photograph all the gentlemen. Like the 70.
Well, Mort's in the new book. And the new book has men. And then Lina and I made a video about a men in style. It's on a website called nowness.com. And it's just under advanced style men. And it just, she brought up Gautier. Jean-Paul Gautier just awarded it best styling at a fashion festival. So that was sort of exciting.
Congratulations.
And yes, I am photographing more men now.
And look for the Nowness piece. It is fabulous. Just fabulous.
The what piece? Say that again.
The video we made. You can just Google
on Nowness.
If you want.
Yeah.
Question over here in the center.
Thank you for a great evening. I'm inspired by you and all the other fabulous women that we met tonight. I also want to say that somebody else is fabulous, my mother, who is fabulous because she's probably still the most intelligent, informed person I know, who knows more about politics and economics and the non-creative professions than anybody I know. And I just wanted to add that all of us women over 30 are fabulous, not just because we wear fabulous lipstick, but because there's a lot of very intelligent points of view and, you know, and things to say, and that's, I think, you are a prime example. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. On your front left here.
Ari, here I am.
Hi, Jerry.
Hi. I know you went to a really great West Coast college.
With your son.
Yes, but I don't know what you studied. Can you tell us about that?
Well, I went to University of Washington and studied art history.
Just up there.
Great.
Seattle. In Seattle, yes. Yes, we were.
Great. Question to your right.
Hi. My name's Kat, and I wanted to thank you, Ari, and you, Deborah. It's so amazing because last night, I don't know why I did this, I was doing Pilates, I turned on the television, which I never watch, and I tuned to the Victoria's Secret fashion show. I can hold it. And I, of course, at first was captivated by their great beauty, and there were some amazing costumes where they were wearing wings and all that sort of thing. But then I started crying because their beauty is just so unattainable. And I'm at this stage in my life, I'm 52, I'm a new empty nester, and I'm struggling with feeling sexy. Like, I want to be a sexy woman, but I don't want to be garish or gaudy, you know? And then tonight I see you, and you're so inspirational, all of the women in the movie, and it's been such a gift. Thank you for that and for what you are and for the vibrancy that you've brought.
Well,
thank you.
Well, one of Sephora's quotes, which I love, and it's not in the film, she said, "Forget tits and ass, wear a hat, you'll get noticed." I think it really says it all.
Okay, on your front left here, front left.
Hi, good evening. I wanted to thank you for the wonderful evening of inspiration, because I have a lot of friends of mine that mock me for the way I dress and tell me that I'm too old and I should calm down, and I tell them all to go to hell. But yes, while I say that, it still at times hurts me a lot, because I think that everybody is entitled to wear and be whatever they feel they should be. And none of us should judge anybody. We are all beautiful women and men.
Right.
Thank you. Question in the back.
I saw the movie Iris. Did you have a part in that film?
Well, they filmed part of it at a party that we had that Iris came to. No, we actually started filming it a long time before they started their film. But we sort of didn't put Iris in our film as much because she was starting to make her own film.
And what age is an advanced style?
That changes all the time. Well, it used to be, I think I was so strict and I wanted it to be 65 and older. And Sephora, when I heard about her, was 59. And then so I waited until she got to be like 62 until I photographed her. But now it's not really a specific age. Generally over 60, but obviously it's an attitude more than an age at this point.
Okay, front left here.
Hi, I'm Marisa. So I'm one of the 20-something that emailed you because really got inspired by your movie. I'm from Indonesia originally, so I'm so excited that I can meet you here in San Francisco. And I know that you are now a very successful blogger with a lot of, you have books and everything, but what is your goal in the future? So after, with all of this success, what are you looking forward to? And I also have one more question for Deborah. So a lot of my classmates, they are always complaining, saying, "Oh my God, I'm already 25, I'm having quarter life crisis, I need to have Botox soon, what should I do?" Or even another girl say, "I want to die before 50, so I won't look old in my dad." So do you have any word of...
her time in New York because she grew up in Sioux City, Iowa, and then went to grad school at Columbia and then made her way to Los Angeles where her mother and the rest of her family moved. And so as a really young boy, I just envisioned going there and sort of reliving those days that she used to speak about. And when she passed away is when I decided, okay, now it's the time to move to New York City. And I think now, reflecting back, I started this project in 2008 as a blog where I was just photographing all these women on the streets of New York that I started to meet, and then it turned into a book and the film and now a new book. And I think I was sort of searching for my grandmother again and finding little bits of her in each one of these women. Lina's wanted to make New York a very strong character in the film, and these women are very New York. But, you know, people say, oh, I can never dress like this in other cities, but that's so not true. I mean, I travel everywhere for my work, and look at Virginia's beautiful work and so many people in the audience, and it's just about doing what makes you feel good. I just moved to Los Angeles, but I loved my time in New York, and I don't think that this would have happened without being there. There's just so much life and color and everything on the streets.
Let's not forget Paris, because a nod to my friend Pascal. I mean, what about you, Deborah? What about your perception of East Coast, West Coast fashion? Tell the truth.
Well, I'm a native New Yorker, and I don't know if it's geography. I mean, I have to blame everything that I do on my mother and my grandmother. And because they were the greatest supporter, at age 3, I was always allowed to dress any way I wanted, and everything was a hat, from a paper bag to a lampshade, and it was encouraged. And of course, when I came to UC Berkeley, that changed my life, as all my friends out there will attest to. We had a professor, Ed Rossback, maybe some of you know him, but East Coast College was completely different than UC Berkeley. East Coast College was very, we're going to chew you up and spit you out and destroy you and see if we can't break you. Came to Berkeley and everything was positive criticism. And it was like life-changing. And, you know, 1967, 69. And my photographer, Dimitri, who photographed my master's dissertation, is here in the audience, and I haven't seen him in over 30 years. So he's the first photographer I worked with, and Ari's the current one. And they're both
I'm out now. She has so many people wanting to take her picture.
So what's so interesting to me, and the work you do is such an antidote to these 12 and 13-year-old prepubescent girls that rule the runways. But the fashion designers are all older people. I mean, the revered ones. If you talk about Giorgio Armani, if you talk about Ralph Lauren, if you talk about Donna Karen and Vogue, Anna Wintour. So what happened? Talk a little bit about how models got younger and younger and thinner and thinner, and how did things get so out of whack?
Well, I mean, the whole focus of this project is really about lifestyle and vitality and really sort of thinking the way we view aging and the picture of aging. And so I was initially drawn by all these women's incredible style, but I don't really think too much about the fashion industry itself. But what's interesting is since I started the project, there have been a lot of changes happening in ad campaigns and lifestyle and fashion media. As you see in the film, I was approached by Lon Vaughn to cast a campaign with two of the women from Advanced Style. Deborah did a Kmart. She's been, you know, modeling for a few years now. All these, and if you, so there's been a big change in that, and it's sort of created this movement where now you're seeing older models on the runway and ad campaigns, and I think people are waking up to the fact that this is not only an important demographic, but, you know, they have the more economic means to be buying the things that are being sold by designers. But there's just this culture of fear around aging, and that's anywhere from the fashion industry to, the New York Times. I mean, there's so much ageism. And, you know, I think at this point, people are starting to look at old as being cool. I don't know how long that will last within the fashion industry, because the fashion industry is very fickle and it's always about what's new and the next thing. But to me, that's not what's important. What's important is to see these images, and hopefully they will, well, they have. I mean, I get emails from young girls from 12 to, you know, women in their 30s who say now they can no longer, they can't wait to grow older because of these women, and they're, you know, lessening their fears when they see that first wrinkle or the gray hair. They're dyeing their hair gray. They can't wait to have as much freedom as the women. So I think there's a lot of changes being made.
And you have Diane Keaton, and you have Charlotte Rampling, and you have Helen Mirren, and we have some really pretty great examples now of women growing old beautifully and unapologetically, and I just love it. You say something in the film, Deborah, and I think it's expressed throughout the film, about there is really a freedom that comes, I find in my own life, a freedom that comes with age, and part of it's, I don't have to do that anymore, or I don't have to pretend that anymore, or particularly for women, I don't have to do that for him anymore. So tell us about that in your own, yeah, right. Tell us about that in your own life.
Well, I think there is a greater freedom, and I first felt it at 50, like I didn't have to answer to anyone. And at that time, I wasn't married, I wasn't with a partner, so I didn't have a male person I had to, you know, bow down to, although I don't think I ever did. But I think just with maturity and being in the world, and, you know, you're not necessarily building a career, you're not raising children, and so there is greater freedom. And I feel that in the aging process, one of the most important things to address is your health. And I think whether you eat well, exercise, but creativity is also very important.
I think that was an amen.
Okay. And as Ari and I were discussing before, we were talking about staying curious and discovering new things. And one of the ladies in the fashion show said, I've never done this before. I said, that's all the more reason you're doing it now.
Our fashion show tonight.
Yeah. So in the green room, she mentioned that. So the whole idea of having new experiences, maintaining friendships. I mentor a lot of young students, and we throw parties all the time, as my partner Stan and I. So we invite young people and older people because we're learning from each other. And as Ari said, he gets emails from young people, and so do I all the time, that they're at 25, they're fearing aging. And the mere fact that they appreciate us and we can all be in the same room and share, it's really gratifying.
I'd love to hear about that, Ari. Tell me about some of the mail you get and interactions you have with young people.
Happy Hanukkah. I just wanted to take a second and recognize two special people. I'm working on a new book, and two of the lovely artists are here, and Mort and Ginny Linder, will you please stand up? And Ginny made this beautiful cape that I'm going to show you.
So, Ari, first of all, I want to thank you for the work you do, and the way you are acknowledging older women, their beauty, their dignity, their creativity. It's just so important and so refreshing. So thank you very, very much. So you credit your grandmothers with getting you started on this road. Would you elaborate a little bit and tell us about their influence in your life?
I grew up in San Diego, and both my grandmothers had a huge impact on me. My father's mother, and my dad's in the front row, Helen, was always beautifully dressed, very intelligent, never left the house without her red lipstick and her hair done, and always promoted education like a good Jewish grandmother. And my other grandmother, Bluma, was really my best friend and the one that I spent most time with. I spent more time with her than anyone my own age. And she had gone to Columbia University. She was a librarian. And really encouraged me at a young age to feel okay with expressing my creativity, dressing up, looking through her closet, not being afraid to put on a sparkly necklace or my grandfather's, you know, Stetson hat, or, you know, just to play and have fun. And I don't think I ever lost that. And she really made me think of aging as a very positive thing. And I know everyone has a grandmother, and people always ask, why did I do this? And I can't explain it other than I've always had this really deep connection to older people. I wanted to be an entertainment director for a nursing home when I was younger. That was my dream.
You got another career.
And in a way, you know, I'm able now to work with all these incredible older people, men and women. And, you know, she introduced me to old film, she's the first person who encouraged me to start collaging, and I made my first book of drawings of older women all dressed up when I was like 7 years old. So this is just an extension of something I've done my whole life. And yeah, I mean, I think they taught me how to treat people well, and I mean, yeah, it's hard to explain. They were everything to me.
So, Deborah, we loved seeing you in the movie. I love looking at what you're wearing, and we're going to get into that. But first of all, I want to hear how you and Ari met.
Oh, it's my favorite part of the story. Ari was managing the bookstore at the New Museum in New York, and I walked in with my very good friend who's in the audience, Susan Wick. She was visiting New York. It was a rainy day. We left our umbrellas and coats at the coat check, and before I knew it, this young man runs up to me and says, I take pictures of women over 60. Can I take your picture? And I blurted out, how do you know I'm over 60?
How old were you at the time?
62.
She had pink hair.
Yeah, I had pink hair, as you saw in the film. And then he realizes he forgot his camera home. So he borrowed somebody's iPhone and took a few shots. And I whipped out my business card and I said, come on over, I'll dress up, I'll undress, and I'll even make you a vegetarian lunch. 5 days passed, I didn't hear from him, so I called him and he came over. So we spent the entire day photographing everything in my house and me cooking and dressing and the art on the walls and whatever. And we were friends after that. And then 2 weeks later, he met Lina, the director of the film, and they decided to collaborate, and she came over, and she was then doing video segments of some of us. And so she's from Lithuania, I'm half Lithuanian, and I said, okay, Lina, I'm going to adopt you. I had already adopted Ari. And so she became a good buddy, and then after doing a series of videos, the two of them, they decided, okay, I think we've got a film, because there was just so much interest in the videos. The film came about. So the two of them were great collaborators.
So let's get into some of what you're wearing, starting with, and if you can't see it too well, I hope you'll be in the atrium afterwards so people can get an up-close look. Tell me about the necklace.
Well, I was just gifted the necklace on Sunday. I have two friends who have a very interesting business. It's called Project Just, and they're interested in the transparency in the whole fashion industry. And one lives in Dubai, and one lives in New York, and I had brunch with them. And the one from Dubai is really from Saudi, and her aunt is now working in Saudi with Syrian refugees, and they made the necklace, and she gifted me. Wow. And it's all wrapped threads, and it's absolutely beautiful. And there's a little piece of embroidery on the bottom, and this is work of the Saudi ladies, and she's also working with Saudi ladies doing embroidered clothing and getting back to the true essence of clothing as we knew it before the whole industry has gotten so polluting.
And I saw in the movie that sometimes you use toilet paper rolls to make bracelets. Is that what this is? Oh, I can't wait till you can see it up close. It has the most intricate fabric, several different fabrics, and leather, and it's just, who would think?
It's just all recycled materials. We all have toilet paper rolls. And, you know, postcards, brochures, catalogs that come in the mail, the images are too beautiful to throw away, so I save them all. And then I just do collage on the cardboard with other fabrics and mesh produce bags. My friends in the audience are all textile people, and so a lot of the stuff comes from them. They send me fabric scraps, and in fact, I'm doing a workshop on Monday out in Berkeley at my friend Ellen Hopley's studio. So oftentimes when we do these films, I do related workshops.
Now, I know that you have a degree in textiles from UC Berkeley, so you have spent time on the West Coast, but this film, as I said earlier, is really New York-centric, and I think you make a comment in the beginning of the film that women get to strut their stuff on the streets of New York because they walk all the time, which we do in San Francisco, certainly more than LA, but talk about New York and the role of New York in this film, and you too, Deborah, having been on the West Coast and in New York. So Ari, start, because you came from Southern California to New York.
Well, I always, my grandmother told me when I was really young that if I wanted to be creative, I should move to New York, and I think she always missed.
Apfel, who's in your film, and who has become, who became such a phenomenon. I mean, just because of her personality, or what happened there? What was it that created the phenomenon of Iris Apfel?
Well, I knew about Iris before I came to New York because as a lot of you might have seen her film, she had a huge show at the Met of all of her clothing that she had collected because she had a business called Old World Weavers, which they made fabrics and
they're also in the interior design business,
and so they made fabrics. It was 18th, 19th century renditions of things, and she did the interior design and the drapery for like the White House through 7 presidents and worked with many fashion designers. So the reason why she was so well known in New York as she was working with all these really high profile people, and she sold her business to Stark, and I mean she had a huge business in interior design, and so people were sort of recognizing her for the way she dressed, and then she had this Met show, and I think that she's just gotten bigger and bigger, and even when I walk down the streets and someone might know me, they bring up Iris because she's in her 90s. She's still so vital, traveling the world, doing her thing. And obviously she has an incredible collection. And she has a sense of humor about the way she dresses. And it's that element of play like that I see in so many other people. And I think that she doesn't take herself too seriously. And I think it sort of gives people, you can see people who are dressed straight out of a store on Madison Avenue or here at Neiman Marcus, and you know, in a way that's unattainable. But you can put on, you know, an armload of full of bracelets or a great necklace or a great hat. And I think that her style, in a way, shows people that you can still have fun, and people can relate to her in a way because they can relate to that sort of process. Yeah. Of accessorizing and building and the joy of dressing.
And very eclectic, you know, so that you're not just reading labels when she steps into a room, but it's a real piece of sculpture.
And also, and I think this is part of what you do, there's the hunt to find that piece, and it might be in a thrift shop, and it might be at a flea market. Well, here we are in an age where our own De Young Museum has done a number of Gautier and shows, designer fashion shows, and certainly they've been in New York, so this doesn't seem like there's any slowing down in the public regard for fashion as art. It just seems to be a steamroller. So, we're going to turn to the audience and take some questions or comments, and we want to see what you look like. But before we do, and before the lights come up, Ari and Deborah, anything else you want to add about this experience, the film, the blog, how your life has grown and flourished under this?
Deborah's changed my life.
Ari's changed my life. Well, we have traveled a lot together, and we just have a grand time. And we've become really good friends, and with Lina also. And it has changed my life. I'm doing more teaching again, more traveling, and it's simpler and better than ever. So it is better with age, as long as we stay healthy and happy.
Ari?
Well, the project has definitely not only changed my perceptions of aging, although that was positive to begin with, but just show me the possibilities, you know, and how you can, if you have that mindset, that optimism, there's no limit to what you can do, and you can do new things, and you can start drawing, you can start painting. My dad just retired, and he started 2 radio shows. If you guys love smooth jazz, check out Smooth Jazz Live on Facebook. And, you know, so many of these women are now rediscovering things in themselves that they have more time to develop. And Deborah, in particular, was the first person I met who, like she said, invited me into her home and really extended this project that I was doing in New York on the streets to really talking about the way you can live a really creative and vital life. And since then, we've traveled to so many different things, including like we were at a conference in the Midwest about aging and disability, and it was run by this great organization that worked with social workers to find community centers that were really helping people in rural communities, which was so different than obviously our experience. But they invited us to have a new perspective on aging. And it was so interesting because in a way we thought, how can they relate to us? But all the social workers came up to us and said, well, all these people who live in these rural communities, well, they weave. They do, you know, they're all sort of crafty people. And so they thought about new ideas. We did a workshop where we had a roundtable discussion. And now it's all about creating community. We talk about creativity and community and connecting. And so now, you know, some of them might not have a museum to go to, but they have the gas station, and that's where they have a bench. And so now they're going to start projects where everyone meets at the bench at the gas station, and they have a weaving circle. And so it's been an incredible gift and for my grandmother to be able to do this and travel and hear stories and wisdom from all these wonderful people.
Wonderful. Well, let's bring the lights up, and we have microphones on either side. And if you want to ask a question or make a comment, just stick up your hand, and there's one right in the front row.
Question for Deborah. Can you hear me?
Yes.
What is at the top of your wish list right now? What are you coveting?
Thank you. Nothing. Oh, my God. To lighten my load and get rid of stuff, but mostly furniture, not clothing, because clothing you can always shove a little more in the closet. Yes. Yeah.
To your left.
Go ahead.
Hi, I'm dying to know your lip color brand so I can buy it tomorrow.
A friend turned me on to it. It's matte. It's a matte, but it's called Jeffrey. Somebody help me. Oh, wait, I have it in my purse.
Oh, I love the purse.
Oh, a friend, Ari named me. My title is Gifted and Thrifted, because I only shop in thrift shops, and almost once a month I get a box of goods from friends from all over the country and the world. My pants are from a friend from Australia. Somebody in a class gave me this. The feathers a friend gave me that are on many hats. A friend from Berkeley's mother passed away at 100, and she sent me 3 cartons of hats that I reinvented. Let me look for the lipstick.
Well, I said it in the film, and it's now the film is online as well, and so people will stop me in the streets and sort of recognize me and say how these women have affected their views on aging, and that's the most amazing part of starting this, because I really just started out of the love of my grandmother. I'd never taken a photograph before. I just hit the streets and started to do this as a way for me to connect to older people, and then I realized that they had the power, these men and women, to change our perceptions of aging. But so many different stories. A woman emailed me a few years ago saying, one of the women in the project is now 103 and she does Pilates every week, twice a week. And she's now been featured in like Pilates magazines and Dr. Oz. And so this woman, on her 50th birthday, by the time she hit 50, she lost 50 pounds because she was inspired by Ruth. And so, I mean, the power of the internet and the power of, you know, just putting something positive online, because there's so much negativity. And so it happens every day, and it's mm-hmm. just really wonderful that I can just sit on my computer in my at my little desk and post a picture and then and see how it affects people.
Go ahead, Deborah. I just want to say one thing about Ari. As you've seen in the movie, he's so non-threatening when he comes up to people, and he's
Well, it depends on who you ask.
Right.
So subtle.
Yeah. And he's not judgmental, and he really, you know, his grandmother taught him well. He really does embrace us, and you can feel his sincerity, that he's not in this as a career, even though it's turned into that. But at the beginning, it totally came from a non-self-conscious place. And his sincerity and honesty is really, really there.
It also struck me that some of the women in the film are artists, but almost all of you, certainly you, Deborah, use your body as your canvas. I mean, your what you do, what you create is your art. And I know I have several friends who are really fabulous fashionistas, and that's a good word. And it never occurred to me before how much of that is art, and that is an expression of an artistic nature. So talk about that a little bit.
Well, I think it's the first act we do in the morning, and I see it as a morning meditation, because it's quiet time to really check in, who am I today for myself, capital S, and how I want to feel for the day, depending on my activity, the weather, my mood, and then how I want to present myself to the world. So I don't see it as narcissistic. For me, it really is a meditation, and it is an act of creativity. And as I say in the film, it's my ABCs, assembling, building, and constructing on this body, which is my armature. And again, I think I've been doing it since I'm 3 years old. And everybody can do it, and you can do it in your own capacity. I mean, it's not brain surgery. So if you dress up and you think you're over the top, and you look in the mirror, and suddenly you feel like you look like a clown, then you take the nose off. And then you pull back the next day. And so it's an experimentation, and it's all play.
And sometimes you want to look like a clown. But that's what I look for, is people who really embrace that art of dressing, and it's not one particular style. And a lot of the people that I interview and speak to about style and lifestyle talk about how it's, you know, this has been a love of theirs since they were little, and that act of playing and continuing to play throughout your lives. And at some point, and this was part of Lina's wanting to film the women that I was photographing, is thinking about why do people, certain people stop at a certain point. Maybe it's for a career, maybe it's to find a partner, whatever, you know, judgments are happening from society, and the ones that continue to play and dress up, and then some people rediscover it as they get older and become even more flamboyant. And today, I don't usually talk about this, but I had a little bit of a cold, and I put this jacket on, and I felt so much better. And I think there really is, you know, that power of style. It changes your mood. When you look in the mirror, and you know you're doing it for yourself. You're not doing it for other people.
Deborah, you said in the film when you were talking about finding your partner and your relationship with him, that there was a point at which you thought you scared him off because you were too over the top. I want to explore that a little bit.
Well, as he said, he thought I looked like a clown.
Right.
And
So you dialed it back.
Yeah.
So
on the first meeting, that's what happened, and then we didn't see each other for 5 years, and then we accidentally re-met at an event. And so, as I said, I did dial it back, and
I really looked in the mirror and I tried to see what a normal person would see. And, you know, I remember exactly what I wore on that first date. You know, a very simple green cotton summer dress, no jewelry, little makeup. I mean, I felt underdressed, but I said, all right, this is an experiment. Let me see. And we went out, and then the other thing, which I think is funny, is afterwards we went out for a beer, and I don't really drink beer, and I'm not really a drinker, and I ordered hot water and lemon. And I did that on the second date, and I said, you know what? He thinks I'm weird enough. I think I better order a glass of wine. So at least he can relate to me as a normal 62-year-old woman at the time.
To what extent do you think, by and large, women do dress for men?
I have to interrupt.
Was heterosexual women?
I have to interrupt because her partner Stan likes to dress up just as much or more as her. They thrift store shop together. He loves the way she looks, and so that was sort of in your own head at that point.
Well, I mean, we were both different people 9, 10 years ago. So, or it was 15 years ago when we first met. So, yeah, I mean, we're really both on the same page in many, many things, and thrifting is certainly one of those things because it's our ritual, you know. When we go for a destination, it's towards a thrift shop.
So. I think there is a culture of, and I'm obviously speaking for women, but in general, of people dressing up, like I said, to attract and for their partners. But it seems like a lot of the women that I photograph really are dressing for themselves more than anyone else. Mm-hmm. And I think that is, you know, a lot of times people will ask me what's the difference between the way younger people dress and the way that the women and men that you photograph dress. And I think it's that whole point of not being self-conscious and really doing something that makes you happy. And you can let go of that fear of being yourself. And I've had that, I'm 34, and I've even, you know, gone through those cycles of when I was younger, I, you know, wore anything out of anyone in my family's closets. And then, you know, you start thinking about, oh, I have to meet someone and I have to dial this down. And then eventually you just get sick of all that and you want to be yourself.
Yeah. Tell us about Iris